The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
All right, so today we are going to start by reviewing income and substitution effects, because that's a pretty hard concept and pretty central to a lot of what we'll do the rest of the semester. And then we're going to dive in and talk about an application, a more interesting application of income substitution effects, which is the effects of wages on labor supply. So let's review. If you take the handout, grab the handout, and look at the first figure. It's the same as the last figure of the previous lecture. To review, remember, whenever the price changes, a price change can be decomposed into two effects: the substitution effect and the income effect. Okay, the substitution effect is the change in the quantity demanded when the price changes, holding utility constant. And as we proved last time, that is always negative, or greater, or zero, or negative. Okay, it's always non-positive. Okay, it's always true that when a price goes up, the substitution effect is negative. We proved that both mathematically and graphically last time, showing that if you're going to hold utility constant and the price of a good's going to go up, you're going to shift away from that good. Okay, that's substitution effect. In our example, we showed graphically how you measure substitution effect is you draw a new imaginary budget constraint, BC3, which is parallel to the new budget constraint, BC2. Okay, so it's got the new price ratio, but tangent to the old indifference curve. So the key thing is to understand this imaginary budget constraint, BC3, where it comes from. It's tangent, it's parallel to the new budget constraint, that is, it's got the new marginal rate of transformation, the new slope, but it's tangent to the old indifference curve. That gets you to point B, and so the movement from A to B is the substitution effect. Okay? Then we have an income effect, which is not only, which is in fact utility isn't held constant when prices change. In fact, utility falls because you're effectively poorer. Okay, you're effectively poorer, utility's falling, and so since you're effectively poorer, that further reduces demand if the good is normal. Okay, so if it's a normal good, if it's a good where lower income causes less consumption of it, the fact that you're effectively poorer further lowers the consumption from point B to point C. So the total price effect is the one we demonstrated at the beginning of the last lecture. We raised the price of movies from $8 to $12. And we saw the number of movies consumed fell from 6 to 4. Okay? But what we can see now is to understand what's underneath that is two things: an effect of the fact that prices change holding the utility constant, and the fact that you're effectively poorer. Okay? Effectively poorer, and that's the key thing, is that no, your income hasn't actually gone down, but that $96 your parents gave you can buy you less. Your opportunity set's been restricted. Okay, and that makes you effectively poor, and so you buy less for that reason. And so you get the total movement from A to C. Okay? Now, as we emphasized last time, this will be the case if it's a normal good. So substitution effects were done. Substitution effects are always negative, nothing fun about that. Income effects are a little more interesting because goods can be not normal, but inferior. We have inferior goods, which are ones such that there's such sort of crummy stuff that as your income goes up, you want less of it. And that can change analysis. So if we look at figure 7.2, now we're talking about the price change with an inferior good. And now imagine someone choosing between steak and potatoes. Okay, so now the choice is between steak and potatoes. Okay? And steak costs $5 a pound initially, and potatoes cost $1 a pound. Initially, you have an income of $25. So someone has an income of 20, y equals 25. Y equals 25. The price of steak is $5. And the price of potatoes is $1. OK? So you can your budget constraint, your original BC1, runs from, you can either have 5 steak or 25 potatoes or something in between. And so individuals choose point A, where they're consuming 8.3 potatoes. Okay, they choose point A. Now, let's imagine that We also ought to, I don't know what the number of stakes is. We probably also ought to label that, the number of stakes that comes from that. But whatever comes out of the utility function. Okay? So then we say, now let us, now let's imagine that the price of potatoes rises to $3 a pound. There's a blight on potatoes like there was in Ireland in the 1800s. There's a potato blight, and that shifts in the supply curve for potatoes, raising the price of potatoes from $1 a pound to $3 a pound. Okay? Now what we know is that that will move consumers, given the utility function that we've chosen here, that will move consumers from point A to point C. Once again, that's not labeled, but some lower amount of potatoes. That'll move them from point A to point C. So ultimately, they'll choose fewer potatoes and fewer steaks. But in fact, what we can see is that's the composition of a substitution effect, which is negative, and an income effect, which is positive. So if we do our standard decomposition, we draw a new imaginary budget constraint, BC3. It's parallel to the new budget constraint, BC2, so same price ratio. Okay, it's parallel. But it is in tangent to the old indifference curve at point B, which is actually to the left of the ultimate choice at point C. So the substitution effect takes us from A to B. The income effect actually takes us back from B to C. That is, as that budget constraint shifts from BC3 to BC2, as you get poorer, you choose more potatoes. Okay? So substitution effect would say that from the price change of potatoes alone, we go all the way to point B. We massively reduce our consumption of potatoes. But because we're poorer, effectively, we now consume more potatoes. Okay, because we're effectively poorer, we now consume more potatoes. Okay? And we now consume more potatoes. And so on net, you get a reduction in potato consumption. Okay, but it offsets the substitution effect. So that's when income effects can be a little more interesting. It's going to be a little more interesting exercise. When income and substitution effects move the same way, it's not that interesting. It's just sort of, look, quantity fail. It doesn't really matter why. You don't care. You don't see in the real world substitution income effects. What's interesting is when they go when they're opposed to each other. That's when it gets more interesting. And so you see this smaller reduction you get from the substitution effect alone. Okay. Now, in principle. By the way, there's two handouts, right, Jessica? Is there two handouts? There should be. There's table as well. I didn't actually get Jessica grabbing one of those. There's tables as well as graphs. So make sure you have both handouts. Anyone else need tables? Am I the only one who did? Okay, good. So basically, in principle, the income effect could be so large it could offset the substitution effect. There's no reason theoretically that couldn't happen. That is, in principle, you could derive preferences such that the income effect is so large it offsets the substitution effect. Thank you. And the price increase actually leads to more potatoes being consumed. That is what we call a Giffen good, as I talked about last time. Okay? So if you look at the table, the top table, this sort of lays out our possibilities. So if goods are normal, so look at the top table, this sort of maps out the possible sets of things that could happen. So if we have a normal good, and the price of that good rises, then we know that the substitution effect is negative, the income effect is negative, so the total effect is negative. Quantity falls. That's the law of demand we talked about last time, downward sloping demand curves. Likewise, if the price falls, the substitution effect is positive, the income effect is positive, you're now richer because the price of a good fell, and so therefore demand goes up. Quantity consumed goes up. Once again, downward sloping demand curve. Price rises, you consume less of it. Price falls, you consume more of it. That's what we learned about in the first lecture. However, once goods are inferior, all bets are off, because now the income effect is the opposite sign of the substitution effect, and it's possible it could be larger. So the total effect is ambiguous. You could actually get an upward sloping demand curve. You could actually get that a price rise leads to more of the good, and a price fall leads to less of the good. Now, will you? Only if it's a Giffen good. And in fact, there's a lot of controversy in economics about whether any good in the world has ever been a Giffen good. At most, there's maybe one or two examples people can find. Even then, it's controversial. Okay. So I think it's fine in life to assume that demand curves slope down. I think, in fact, I don't see convincing evidence that any substantive set of goods are Giffen goods. And I think it's just generally fine in life to assume demand curves slope down. Nonetheless, it's important to understand this theoretical possibility. even if it's just theoretical, because it's important to understand income and substitution effects. Okay? Questions about that? About income substitution effects or price changes. Okay. So now, armed with that, let's go on to the more interesting case, which is labor supply. It's more interesting because, as I'll come to in a few minutes, we talk about labor supply. Labor is always going to be, is typically going to be an inferior good. So things are going to get a little more interesting. So let's talk about that. So the question you want to ask here is, how hard do folks decide to work? How many hours of labor do folks decide to provide? Now, as we talked about when we talked about minimum wage, just as we all have to decide between consuming pizza and consuming movies, or consuming steak, consuming potatoes, we also have to decide between how much labor we're going to provide and how much we're going to consume. The more labor you provide to the market, the more you can consume, but the less fun you get to have. Fun we call leisure. The less labor provided to the market, the more fun you get to have, the more leisure you get, but the less you get to consume because you have less income. And that's the trade-off we talked about. We talked about the effect of the minimum wage. Now let's come back and get underneath that labor supply curve. So we talked about the minimum wage, talked about the labor supply curve, which was your how the hours you provide respond to the wage, and a labor demand curve, which was how the hours that firms want respond to the wage. Now let's get underneath the supply curve. Okay? A minute ago we were talking about demand curves, getting underneath the demand curve for consumers. Well, now let's get underneath the supply curve for labor. Okay. Now, the key thing is that when we talk about labor, it's not a good, it's a bad. Okay? The typical person doesn't want to work. Typical person is not in this room. You guys like to work. Okay? The typical person actually doesn't like to work. Okay? So leisure is a normal good. For the typical person, leisure is a normal good. They like time off. Okay? So what that means is that leisure is a good, which means labor is a bad. They don't like to work. The problem is we don't know how to model bads in economics. Okay? It's just we're used to trade off between two things you want. We're not used to trade off, we know how to model something you want against something you don't want. Indifference curves wouldn't work because more wouldn't be better. Right? If you drew an indifference curve for labor, it would violate the more is better assumption because you wouldn't want more, you'd want less. So the modeling trick we're going to use whenever we're modeling bads is to model the complementary good and then, in the end, solve for the bad. We're not going to model labor, we're going to model leisure. And given a total amount of hours you have to supply, the total hours minus the amount of leisure is the amount of labor. So we're going to model leisure, we're going to model the good, and then solve for labor at the end. Okay? So in other words, if you have 24 hours a day you can work, then your amount of hours of work is 24 minus the amount of leisure. N, call it N or call it L, whatever we want to. Well, we'll call it N because L typically we think of as labor. So we think of, let's call leisure N for reasons I don't quite understand. Let's just use that. Okay? That basically the amount of hours you can work is 24 minus leisure. So if we solve for the optimal amount of leisure you want, we can obviously get the amount of labor you supply. So the trick when modeling a bad is not to model the bad, it's to model the complementary good. In this case, the complementary good is leisure. So we're going to model the trade-off between leisure and consumption and use the result of that to solve for the amount of labor you supply. Okay? So it's the general modeling trick you need to understand, which is turn a bad into a good. That's the modeling trick. Because we know how to model the trade-off between two goods. We don't know how to model the trade-off with a bad. Okay? So to think about that, let's go to figure 7.3 and let's talk about what's underneath a labor supply curve. What's underneath a labor supply curve is the trade-off between how much leisure you want and how much consumption you can have. So you see here, here's a trade-off where on the y-axis is the amount of goods you can have. You earn a wage W. The y-axis is the amount of goods you can have from a day's work. Okay, so you earn W per hour. That means the most goods you can have from a day's work is 24W. If you worked all 24 hours at that wage, you could have 24W goods. Okay. On the other hand, if you worked not at all, Then you take 24 hours in leisure and have no consumption from that day. Okay? So as we see, as you move to the right on the x-axis, that's leisure, that's the good. As you move to the left, that's labor, that's the bad. Okay? That's just illustrating you, but what we're going to model is the good. We're going to model leisure. So your trade-off is between how much you want to consume and how much leisure you want to take. Now, here's what's interesting. What is a budget constraint? What's the slope of a budget constraint? Not what's the answer here, but in general, what determines the slope of a budget constraint? What determines the slope of a budget constraint? Yeah? Which is what?
Ratio between prices.
Ratio between prices. Prices determine the slope of budget constraint. But here's what's tricky. What's the price of leisure? The wage, why?
Because for every hour you take having leisure, you are effectively losing money that you could gain out of work.
Exactly. The key is the economic concept of opportunity cost, which we've talked about and we'll continue to talk about this semester. Opportunity cost. By not working, you are forgoing earning a wage. So that is the price of leisure. You may not think of it this way, but once again, that's why we're the dismal science. When you go home today and you sit on the couch and you watch TV for an hour, you have just paid a price. And that price is what you could have earned by working that hour. Every action has a price. And the price of leisure is the wage you the wage you forego by sitting around is the price of leisure. So the slope of this budget constraint. So if goods, let's assume here that goods, that the price of goods is a dollar, that the goods you're going to buy are cost a dollar, okay? Whatever consumption costs a dollar. It's the trick we always use with modeling. Make as many things a dollar as you can. That makes the modeling easy. So let's assume that the price of the goods you're going to buy are a dollar. So the slope of the budget constraint is minus W over 1. Okay, the slope of the budget constraint is just the price of leisure, which is minus W. Okay, so the trade-off with the price of goods of 1, the trade-off between taking leisure and consuming is that if you take leisure, you get W, an hour of leisure, you get W fewer goods. Okay? And if you work an hour, you get W more goods, but you lose an hour of leisure. Okay? And that gives you the trade-off between how much you consume and how much leisure you take, which determines how much you work. Okay, questions about that? Now let's take this framework and ask, what happens when the wage changes? Figure 7.4. So we have an original outcome with a budget constraint BC1. Okay? Now imagine that the wage, we have original budget constraint BC1. Now imagine the wage goes up. So we move to BC2. BC2 is a budget constraint with a higher wage. Okay, the wage goes up. So what we're going to see is you're going to move from point A, where you work N1 hours, to point C, where you work N3 hours. Okay, that's where your difference curves are tangent with the new budget constraint. The wage going up, we take leisure of N1 hours to leisure of N3 hours. The wage going up has reduced your leisure. Which makes sense. If the wage goes up, you work harder, right? So your wage going up, we always first think in terms of leisure, then convert to labor. Wage goes up, leisure falls from N1 to N3, which means labor goes up. But actually, two things are happening here, the substitution income effect. The substitution effect is, which we see by drawing the imaginary budget constraint BC star, okay? Which is parallel to BC2 but tangent to the original difference curve, the substitution effect is a very large reduction in leisure. It moves all the way from N1 to N2. Okay? Substitution effect is a very large reduction in leisure. The income effect is that leisure is a normal good. I'm now richer because my wage has gone up, so I want to buy more of it. So I buy more leisure, and that moves me from N2 to N3. Okay? So basically, now the income effect offsets the substitution effect even with a normal good. Okay, or with a normal good. with a normal good, the income effect offsets the substitution effect. Okay? And that's because the money you're getting, you're using to buy leisure. Okay? So in fact, if you flip to 7.5, you can see a case where the income effect dominates, and actually you get that where the income effect dominates, and you actually get that a wage increase leads you to work less hard. Now think about that. If I'd said to you, I probably should have started with this, if you increase wages, people work more hard or less hard, your initial instinct would have been more hard. You would have thought, well, if your wage goes up, you work harder. But that's because your instinct was focused on the substitution effect. You think about the income effect. Here's a case where I start at N1. The substitution effect leads me to N2. But I feel so much richer from that higher wage that I actually move all the way to N3. My leisure goes up, and I work less hard. Now, unlike a Giffen good, this is totally plausible. Why is it plausible? Well, let me give you simple intuition for why it's plausible. Let's say that you're someone who has a certain amount of things you want to buy every week. You don't save. You have a certain amount of things you want to buy every week. You have to pay your rent. You have to buy your food. You have to buy your other goodies. You have a certain budget. Okay, a lot of people live on a budget. You have a certain budget. And the truth is, you're happy with that budget. That's kind of what you want to do. Okay? Now let's say I doubled your wage. Well, now to meet the budget, you can work half as hard and still meet the same budget. So you work less hard, right? You could say, look, I can get more leisure and consume the same amount of goods as I did before, so I'll work less hard. Okay? That's a totally plausible case. That's a case of what we call target income. If someone has a target income and their wage goes up, they'll work less. Now, that's not necessarily the truth, but it's at least, to me, sort of a plausible case of how people might behave. And that's a case where income effects can dominate. Okay? So if we once again go to the second chart on that page, okay? The second chart on the page, now we see income substitution effects for labor supply. Now, if leisure, assuming leisure is a normal good, we're always going to assume leisure is a normal good. We're never going to assume people don't like leisure. Okay? Assuming leisure is a normal good, then as the wage rises, the substitution effect is you take less leisure. So now, this table's a bit different than the other table. Instead of the first panel being normal, the second panel being inferior. The first panel is what happens to leisure. The second panel converts it to what happens to labor. So for instance, in the first cell, when the wage rises, the substitution effect on leisure is unambiguously negative. You clearly take less leisure when the wage rises. So likewise, you have more labor. So in the bottom panel, labor is clearly greater than less than zero. But the income effect is positive for leisure. You're rich, you take more leisure. Or likewise, negative for labor. You're richer, so you work less hard. And therefore, the net is ambiguous. Okay? So with goods consumption, we needed goods to be inferior for there to be a Giffen good type phenomenon. Here, even with leisure being normal, you can have a Giffen good type phenomenon. It's much less random. And in some sense, this is why we learn income substitution effects. To be honest, they're just not that interesting for consumption. Okay? The book makes a big deal out of them and talks about consumer price indices and all that. It's just not that important, okay, for consumption. Because we know consumption, price goes up, you consume less. It's just not that interesting. It's much more interesting for things like labor supply, and we talk about savings in a number of lectures, the same thing. There it's more interesting because now they can often offset each other in meaningful ways. And so now this is why the tools of income substitution effects become much more important. Okay? So if we put this together, if we go to figure 7.6, okay, and we can now think about deriving where labor supply comes from. Okay, where does labor supply come from? Well, first you've got the consumer's decision how hard to work. So here's a case, it's sort of small, but you can take a look. Okay, here's a case where you've got someone initially taking 16 hours of leisure, and therefore working 8 hours, at a wage of W1. Now their wage goes up to W2. They choose to take 12 hours of leisure, and therefore work 12 hours. So this is someone for whom, this is someone who works harder when the wage goes up. That is, the income effect does not offset the substitution effect. Okay? Now, we can take that to draw a demand for leisure curve, just like we do any other demand curve. Okay? Same technique as last time. You just bring those points there and say, look, at a wage of W1, leisure 16, at a wage of W2, leisure 12, we have a downward sloping demand for leisure. Standard downward sloping demand for leisure. But we can convert that to a supply of labor, which is what we care about. Nobody cares about the demand for leisure curve. We care about the supply of labor curve, but that's just, you just subtract these from 24. You get supply of labor curve, which is upward sloping. So as long as substitution effects dominate income effects, we'll get an upward sloping labor supply curve. But it's certainly possible that if income effects dominate substitution effects, you could get a downward sloping supply curve. If you will, what we call in labor economics, a backward bending supply curve. A supply curve that goes the wrong way. Instead of sloping up like supply curves are supposed to, it goes the wrong way and slopes down. And we can see that's plausible. The target income case I just described to you would deliver that. The target income case I described to you would deliver a downward sloping supply of labor. As the wage rose, people would work less and less. Okay? So that's a totally plausible case. Okay? And that's why income substitution effects are interesting, because they can deliver this weird result that you can get the wrong signed supply curve. Okay, questions about that? That income substitution effects or labor supply. Okay. So what I want to spend the rest of the lecture then on is talking about, well, what is the case? Do labor supply curves slope up or down? And what do we know about that? Well, this is probably the major focus of a field we call labor economics, which there's an excellent course in labor economics, 1464, taught by Josh Angrist, which goes into much detail in the entire field. But one of the main focuses of the field is understanding the elasticity of labor supply, and is it positive or negative, and how big is it? So basically, measuring the slope of the labor supply curve is a focus of this literature, the elasticity of labor supply. Now, what I want to do is start with a historical fact, and then I'll come to the modern age. Let's think about 30 years ago. 30 years ago, all men worked, and less than half of women worked. It was more normal for women not to work than to work. Okay, married women, I'm sorry. Less than half of married women work. Okay? Now, married women could work. I'm not talking 60 years ago where there were or 80 years ago where there were marriage bars, and literally firms wouldn't hire if you were married. It's true. You can actually, if you're interested in that, you can actually read Claudia Golden's, a labor historian, who's written about the early 20th century when literally women could be fired for being married. Okay? We're not talking about that era. I'm talking about 30 years ago when you could work if you were married. It was no problem, but most women chose not to. Okay? Maybe 40 years ago now. Okay, so in that case, let's think about two groups. Let's think about married men, and let's think about married women. And let's just posit, hypothetically, how big we think their substitution and income effects would be. How big their substitution and income effects would be. Let's start with substitution effect. Do we think the substitution effect would be bigger? Now, this is the change in the wage holding utility constant. Do we think that would have a bigger effect on leisure and therefore labor for men or for women? And why? Don't yell it out. Somebody raise their hand and tell me. Do we think that the substitution effect would be bigger for men or women? And why? Remembering the name, it's the substitution effect. That's the key to the answer. Yeah.
They're going to be the same because they each have equal use for the goods. Maybe their income effect would be different, but I think.
Okay, let's talk about income effects. They each have equal use for the goods. Well, let's see what the substitution effect comes from. Let's break it down. Okay, so you're someone who's deciding. You've got you and your wife, okay, and you're each deciding how to respond to a change in the wage. Now, you both value the goods the same, okay? But it's goods versus leisure. What's the other feature that you're going to be thinking about? Think about a married man 40 years ago, and the wage goes down. No, the wage goes. No, we're just doing substitution effects. That's not ambiguous. The wage goes down, they work less. We're just doing substitution effects. That's ambiguous. The question is, if they work less, what do they do? Whereas think about a woman, if she works less, married woman 40 years ago, if she works less, what does she do? What does a married man do? Nothing. There's nothing to do. Your friends are all at work. You can't go play golf. Okay? You can't do anything. You don't take care of kids because men don't take care of kids 40 years ago. Okay? What do? There's nothing to do. Whereas a woman, married woman, if the wage goes down 40 years ago, you can take care of kids instead. You can hang out with other women who aren't working. There's plenty to do. Okay, based on that, now change your answer. Where do you think the substitution effect would be bigger?
In
women, it would be bigger. Because men, there's less of a substitution effect because it's all about substitutability of options. There's no good alternative option to work for men 40 years ago. It's either work or nothing. I mean, basically, everybody worked. Okay? So basically, there's no good substitution effect option for men. For women, there's lots of outside options. There's sociability, there's child rearing, etc. The substitution effect will be larger the more things there are you can substitute to. Okay? Men don't have anything to substitute from work. Women have options to substitute through from work. So this is, for men, this is going to be very small. For women, this will be big. Okay? We know the sign. It's always got to be, you know, smallest can be a zero. Okay? We know the sign. Okay? But it's going to be a very small substitution effect because it's not, I don't have a lot else to do if my wage goes down. Women, if it's a low wage, why work? Okay? You can do much more effective taking care of the kids or hanging out with your friends. Why work for a low wage? Men, there's nothing else to do. Okay? So that's the relative size of the substitution effects. Okay? Now, the income effect, I think, is a little bit harder. And let's come back and think about what drives an income effect. Okay? What's going to drive an income effect is going to be, we talked about the income effect as being, you know, delta Q, delta Y. Okay, how much the quantity changes when your income changes. But in reality, what's going to matter for your income effect, given when you start today, is going to be not only delta Q, delta Y, how your taste for work changes, your income changes, but also how hard you work to start. Think of it this way. The income effect is how much richer you feel if your wage goes up, or how much poorer you feel if your wage goes down. If you are working 0 hours, the income effect is zero. You don't feel any richer if the wage goes up because you don't earn any money. Okay? The more hours you work, the bigger the income effect is, because the bigger that shock is to you. So we can think of the income effect, a shorthand for the income effect, is going to be H times dHdy. The hours you work times how your hours change with your income. Okay? This is, now, to prove this involves using complicated algebra we're not going to get into in this course. I worked hard last night to see if I could make the algebra less complicated, and I can't. I just have to just try to work with me intuitively on this. The notion that the income effect is bigger the more you're in the market. You can think about it for goods, too. Okay? Think about the income effect of a change in the price of something you buy a lot of for something you buy very little of. So let's say you're someone who's buying 2 Starbucks a day, okay, and you very rarely very rarely go see a movie. Okay? Well, if the price of a movie goes up 10%, or the price of Starbucks goes up 10%, which is going to make you feel poorer? The price of Starbucks going up, because you buy a lot of Starbucks. So how much poorer you'll feel, or the income effect, will depend on your starting point. Okay? The more you're in a market, the more you'll feel the income effect. Now, based on that, who's going to have a bigger income effect, men or women? Same person. What do you think? The income effect's going to be stronger the more you're in the market. So who's going to have a bigger income effect?
Married men would have a bigger.
Exactly. Married men would have a bigger income effect because they're in the market. Married women, most of them don't work, so there's no income effect. Right? So this is going to be big for men and small for women. Now, I'm assuming dHdy, there's another issue, which is, does dHdy differ for men and women? I'll leave that alone. Okay? Let's assume they both have the same underlying income elasticity. Okay? But certainly the initial hours are much bigger for men than for women. Okay? So, what does this mean in terms of the labor supply curves you would see for married men and married women 40 years ago. Based on these facts, what would you think? Yeah. Yeah, so in particular, the female labor supply curve would look like what? Would slope up or down?
It would slope up.
It would slope up. You'd have an upward sloping because you'd have these big substitution effects and small income effects, so it would look much more like figure 7-4. Okay? You'd have the big substitution effect when the wage goes up and a small offset income effect. Think about the woman who's not working at all. She's not working at all $8 an hour. You raise her wage to $12 an hour. She's like, hey, I wasn't working at all, so there's no income effect, but now I'm going to go to work and make some money. So it's upward sloping. But for men, it's going to look more potentially like figure 7-5. There's a small substitution effect, but potentially big income effect, or bigger than women. Now, how big it is, that's not clear, because once again, men have nothing to do if they don't work. So it could be that this ends up being, you know, this is bigger and smaller. It's not clear how big this ends up being, okay? But it's at least possible that you could have men having backward bending or downward sloping labor supply curve, because the income effect could even more than offset the substitution effect. But in reality, given the way I set up the example, you'd think men would basically have pretty inelastic labor supply. You think 40 years ago, these things would basically be zero, both offset, and basically you have a situation where the change in the wages didn't matter much for men. Okay? And in fact, that's what people found. This is a wonderful case of the convergence of truth with theory, okay, and a wonderful case of the power of some pretty simplistic theory. The intuition exactly borne out in the data, which is males 40 years ago were very inelastic labor supply. Their labor supply curves were virtually vertical and maybe backward bending. There's some controversy on that. Okay? Some estimates got backward bending, some didn't. But certainly not upward, not upward sloping, basically vertical. Okay? Women had very elastic labor supply with elasticities estimated to be around 1. That is, every 1% change in the wage led to 1% more labor supply. So that's elastic, fairly elastic labor supply for women, where for men the estimate was basically 0. Okay? And that's kind of neat because we're actually getting confirmation of the data of what the theory would have told us. Okay? Now, someone else tell me, what do you think has happened over the last 40 years to these relative to these elasticities of married men and married women? Yeah. Why? Speak up so the class can hear you. Why is that? Women work more often now. So the income effect is going to be getting bigger for them. Okay. So the income effect's going up because their initial H is bigger. Okay. The income effect. Plus, there's actually now, in some sense, less good opportunities if you're not working. So when we had our first kid and we lived in Brookline, which is sort of an urban city, and my wife decided to stay at home, she didn't have moms to hang out with. It was just nannies at the park. And it wasn't that much fun. And so basically, the substitution effect is shrinking because the outside options aren't quite as good as they were as the norms become shift towards work. Whereas for men, actually it's becoming more normal for men to be engaged in childcare. My best friend's a stay-at-home dad. Okay? It's becoming more normal for that to happen. Okay? And so the substitution effect is rising. It's not implausible that if you cut a man's wage down, he'll just say, forget it, my wife's going to work, I'm going to take care of the kids. That would be socially ostracizing 40 years ago, but it's not that odd now. Okay? And likewise, as men are less engaged in the labor force, they're spending more time at home, their income effects are falling because their initial H is smaller. So you're getting a convergence in these labor supply elasticities. What really seems to be happening is mostly convergence down for women, not much up for men. So men are maybe going from 0 to 0.1. Women are coming from like 1 to a half. So you're seeing so what you're seeing is that men aren't actually working that much less. There's a few stay-at-homes to add, but they're still not the majority. Women are working a lot more, and kids are in childcare a lot more. Okay? So what you're seeing is over time, you're seeing men being a little more responsive, but not that much more responsive, still basically working all the time. Women working a lot more and being more responsive to wages. And the reduction coming in both women's leisure and in production of child care at home. Okay? Now, that raises a very interesting question of, is this a good thing? Now, this is a very deep and hard topic. In economics, we think if people do something, it's good, or they wouldn't have done it. Okay? But it is true, if you look at data on self-reported well-being or happiness data, married women report a general decline in happiness over the last 40 years as they've entered the labor force more and more. Okay? And the issue is, is this something which is a good way for society to spend its resources, to have everyone working, consuming more? Consumption's gone up. We're consuming more, but we're getting less leisure as a family, because the men aren't working that much less, the women are working a lot more. So we're getting less leisure as a family. Is that, how to deal with that outcome? That's an interesting question. We'll talk about that some more later on in the semester. Okay? Questions about this? Yeah? You know, that's a really good question. Let me talk about that for a couple minutes. The definition of unemployment, okay, is those looking for work, is those employed overlooking for work. Okay? So if the number of people employed does not change, and women suddenly want to work, and they report to surveyors they're looking for work, the unemployment rate is going to be those looking overemployed. My bad. The unemployment rate is going to be those looking over those employed. Okay? The unemployment rate is how many people are looking for work relative to how many employed. If women suddenly say are suddenly looking for work, okay, and there's no jobs for them to be had, that will raise the unemployment rate. So one thing that's been a focus of a lot of research has been, do increase in the supply of labor lead to increases in unemployment? What you've expressed is what's often called the lump of labor view. The lump of labor view is basically the view that there's a fixed box of production in the economy. And as more workers come in to fill that box, there'll be more unemployment. The alternative view is that the economy is dynamic, and as more women are working and earning income and buying stuff, that makes more jobs. So our standard of consumption is way higher than 40 years ago. Okay? We all have much cooler stuff than 40 years ago. You have no idea how bad life sucked 40 years ago. Okay? Okay? We have way better stuff. We have that stuff because women are working and making the income to buy it, which means people have to make it, which makes jobs. So in fact, the existing evidence is labor supply shocks do not cause unemployment increases. Okay? This is something I've worked a lot on. What you see, a very interesting case is in Europe. Okay, in the US, in all over the world, we have systems for what we call Social Security. Okay, Social Security, a term you've all heard, I'm sure. The Social Security program is a program which provides income when you're retired. Okay, so provides income when you're retired to help you deal with the fact that you don't have a source of labor income anymore. And that's a program virtually every country, and all developed countries have a very generous Social Security program. But they're different in the US than in other countries. Okay? In the US, the way the Social Security program works is when you hit 62, you get a choice. You can stop working and get your benefits from Social Security, and then you get them every year till you die. Or you can keep working, delay getting your benefits, but they'll increase what you get to offset the delay. So in other words, if I retire at 63 rather than 62, given that I'm going to die at the same date, I'm going to get one fewer year of benefits over my life. But they raise them by 6.7% to compensate for that. So I get one fewer year of benefits, but every year 6.7% higher. And it turns out, given life expectancy, that works out to be a roughly fair deal. So basically, at 62, your choice is I can get one more year of benefits or get higher benefits for one fewer years. And that's the choice, and it's a roughly fair deal. Okay, questions about that? Am I making sense of that? Okay. In Europe, it's not a fair deal. In Europe, the way it works is they say you can get one more year of benefits, but if you decide to work this year, we're not giving you any more in the future. Okay? So let me describe how it works in the Netherlands. At age 55, the Netherlands says, If you decide to retire this year, we will replace 90% of your wages in Social Security payments to make sure your income doesn't suffer when you retire. If you don't retire and work, you're going to give up sitting at home earning 90% of your wage. That is the opportunity cost of working, is you have foregone the ability to sit at home and get 90% of your wage. So what is your net wage if you work? 10% of what you would have earned. So if you're earning 20 bucks an hour, then your choice is you can sit at home for 18 bucks an hour or work for 20 bucks an hour. So your net wage for working is $2 an hour. The return to work, the opportunity cost, okay, of work, the opportunity cost of leisure is only $2 an hour. You're only forgoing $2 an hour by sitting at home. But wait, there's more. If you sit at home, you don't have to pay the payroll taxes that finance this system that are almost 50%, okay? If you work, you have to pay the payroll taxes, which means that if you work, you lose money. Because if you work, you forgo getting to sit at home at 90% of your wage, and you pay a tax that's about 40% of your wages. So actually, you will lose 30% of your salary by working relative to sitting at home. Guess what people do in the Netherlands at 55? They sit at home. No one works after 55 in the Netherlands on the books. They work off the books, painting houses and doing odd jobs. No one works on the books after 55. Economics works, guys. If you pay guys to stay at home, they stay at home. Okay? Now, if you ask European politicians, why do you have this screwed up system? They'll say, well, it's easy. We want to get those old guys out to make jobs for the young guys. We need to pay those old guys to stay at home to make jobs for the young guys. And then you point out, gee, have you noticed that Europe has higher unemployment than America? Even though we don't do that and you do, and that's because you're wrong. Okay? It doesn't work that way. Because by paying the old guys to sit at home, you have to have such high taxes that no one makes new businesses. And so there's not jobs for the young guys to have. So it's true, in theory, you've made jobs for the young guys by keeping the old guys at home. But by imposing the 40% tax rate you've had to impose to make it possible to pay the old guys to sit at home, you've killed job creation in your country. And as a result, there's not the jobs for young guys to get. So in fact, so it's a long, very long-winded way of answering your question about basically that supply does not, supply in some sense creates its own demand. Okay, and so more labor supply will not necessarily cause more unemployment. Okay, I want to talk about one more thing before we stop, which is I've just talked about a vast empirical literature and how people understand the effect of wages on labor supply. Well, how do they do it? We could say, well, look, we can just look at, you know, you earn a higher wage than you, and we'll ask, do you work harder than you? Okay? And we'll say, gee, the guys who earn higher wages work harder. If guys earn higher wages work harder, that means labor supply slopes up. If guys earn higher wages don't work harder, that means labor supply slopes down. What's wrong with that? Yeah? Yeah, basically, maybe you guys are different. Okay? Maybe you're talented and you're not. Okay? And maybe because you're talented, maybe you're driven and you're not. Okay? And because you're driven, you work harder and get paid a higher wage. So I'm not learning anything about the causal effect of the wage on your labor supply. I've just documented a correlation between wage and labor supply. How can we get the causal effect of your wage on your labor supply? Well, once again, ideally, we'd run an experiment. We'd assign you a higher wage. We'd find someone just like you, not you, you're not driven. Okay, we'd find someone just like you. No offense, you know I'm joking. Okay, we find someone just like you, okay, and randomly by flip of a coin assign them a lower wage, and we'd see how your labor supply differed. Okay? Now, it seems like, gee, you couldn't do that, but in fact, the US did that. In the 1970s, we ran what was called the negative income tax experiment, where we literally assigned people different wage rates through taxing them by different amounts. And that was gave us this very convincing evidence from 40 years ago of these responses. So where we get this is from a real experiment we ran 40 years ago. The problem is that's a pretty hard experiment to run. It's pretty expensive, and there's some ethical issues. Okay? So what do you do today to estimate that? What you can do today is say, well, look, we can't run the experiment, but the government runs it for us every time they change tax rates. Because if you take two people who are identical, so let's say you and you are identical, okay, and I change your tax rate because you live in Massachusetts, I don't change your tax rate because you live in New York, I can see what happens to you relative to you. Because I've now essentially run this experiment by the government changing someone's tax rate and someone else's not. And that's the kind of way, that's the way we do it if we can't run a true randomized experiment. And that gives very, very similar answers. Okay? Let me stop there, and we will come back. Next lecture, we'll talk about applying this model. And then, so I guess we have a section on Friday we review for the exam. Section Friday, review for the exam, so show up to that. And the exam is next week. The exam will cover through my next lecture.